Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Come on in and have a seat. We want to welcome everybody here. We're glad to see you this morning, and we look forward to our time together as we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Hope all of you have a bulletin. Look over those announcements and participate as fully as you can in the work and ministry of the church this week. You will notice that our Lenten Wednesday night series starts February 22nd. Heath may have more to say about that subsequently, but go ahead and mark your calendars. We'll be having dinner and Bible studies and so forth during the season of Lent, which will begin with Ash Wednesday on February the 22nd. If you're visiting today, we have a starting point class just for you next Sunday morning and for 5 weeks thereafter. In the office suite conference room, we invite you to come and be part of that. And if you're a lazy member, a backsliding member, you're not going to Sunday school anywhere, member, then come to my class. We'll be glad to have you in there, and maybe I can fix you a little bit. I don't know. Maybe you can fix me a little bit. Good to have all of you here. Let's prepare our hearts now to worship the Lord. Psalmist says, I will tell of your name to my brothers in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. Let's do that as we stand together and read responsively from Psalm 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we worship you, for you are worthy, you are great, and you're greatly to be praised, and you're gracious, and you're loving and kind and merciful, and you will not let our souls be lost, for we've been bought by you at such a cost. We thank you for that cost, the precious blood of Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and in whose name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. These first 10 Sundays of the year, we're looking at the Ten Commandments. This is the third Sunday of the new year. So we come to the third commandment today, a good refresher for us all to remember what the Lord has commanded of his people and what our church standards and scripture have to say about these commandments. So responsively, which is the third commandment? The third commandment is, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, but not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. What is required in the third commandment? The third commandment requires the holy and reverend use of God's names, attributes, ordinances, word, and works. What is forbidden in the third commandment? The third commandment forbiddeth all profaning, abusing of anything whereby God maketh himself known. Together we bow before the Lord to confess our sins and ask his forgiveness. Together we pray. Father, we confess that we have broken your commandment. We have not reverenced your name, titles, attributes, words, sacraments, prayers, and deeds as we should. We have abused your name by using it in careless, superstitious, ambiguous, and wicked ways. And that you would forgive us and allow us to escape the curse of this commandment. Give us hearts that desire to honor your holy name. We ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who became a curse for us, that we might receive your blessing. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are reminded of how sinful we are and how much we need a Savior. And only you can save us from our sin. Only you can grant us everlasting life. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. So help us, we pray, and forgive us and cleanse us and bless us, strengthen us, heal us. We pray for those among us that are sick and in need of your mercies. We think of Denny Brownlee recovering from surgery and Bill Seary with his upcoming surgery. For numerous ones undergoing treatments of one sort or another, Tim Cummings and Christy Frazier and Cheryl Stinnett, Linda Hutton. We give thanks that Charlie Smith is apparently coming home this week for rehabilitation. We pray that you would bless him and others who suffer from chronic pain and discomfort. There are many needs among us, Lord. Some are lonely, discouraged, fearful, anxious. But your grace, so your word tells us, is sufficient for every need that we have. May the Son of Righteousness rise with healing in its wings upon all of us, that we may go out leaping like calves from the stall. We give thanks for the church in Kenya, in which we have an interest through our brother Bill Kenny and Debbie, and thank you that they worship in a new sanctuary today. I pray that you'd bless these, our brothers and sisters in distant lands. We pray for Nancy Wilkes, too, knowing of her recent illness. We pray for parents among us as they seek to raise their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Again, Lord, we need your help, your wisdom, your strength and guidance. May we lean not to our own understanding, but rather in all of our ways acknowledge you, knowing that you will indeed direct our paths. Bless our missionaries. We pray for them and for their strength and well-being and for their encouragement in the gospel. We pray that you'd bring an end to the conflict in the Ukraine. We pray that you would bless your church there and in Russia and all around the world. Blessings abound wherever you reign, Lord. And so set prisoners free, prisoners of sin, prisoners of suffering, and grant a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon the four corners of the earth, that your elect will come forth and that you will call lost ones unto yourself, and that there may be a great work of the Spirit in our day. We thank you for this time of prayer. Your house is to be a house of prayer, and so we give thanks that you hear us and answer us according to your perfect will. Through Jesus Christ our Savior we pray. Amen. We read the third commandment, and the Bible says if we break the commandment in one place, we've broken it in all. And if you're like me, you look at that third commandment and you say, guilty, guilty as charged. How many times have we misused or abused or been careless, used God's name as an interjection or exclamation or even worse? And as the Bible says, we'll be held accountable for every idle word. So we know we need a great Savior, don't we? And we have one. We sung earlier this morning, for my life he bled and died, God's justice has been satisfied. And every idle word has been placed upon him, and all of our sins removed as far as the east from the west. And through Christ, God's justice has been satisfied. And therefore, if we forgive our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. There is a fountain filled with blood, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Let's celebrate the grace of God as we sing together.
Jesus. Please be seated. We just want to take a moment once again to welcome you to Stevens Valley Church. We're so glad that you're with us this day. If you're sitting on the inside row, there should be an attendance pad there when you walked in. Would you please pass those outward? And if please make your attendance known with us. If you're a visitor, we're especially glad to have you. Let us know that you were here so that we can get in touch with you, get to know you. We have a plethora of different opportunities for you to plug into the life of this church. Among them, the Women's Bible Study, which started this past Tuesday. It's a great time for the ladies in this church. If you're a lady and looking for a Bible study, it's a wonderful opportunity. We have several men's Bible studies and various other activities. I wanted to go ahead and announce today, our Wednesday nights, we'll begin promoting them in the near future, but the Lenten Wednesday night series, the first week on the 22nd, we are going to do a roundtable discussion on evangelism and some Q&A. If you're interested in learning how to share your faith with your neighbors, with your coworkers, and the like, that'd be a great event for you to come to. You might learn some things about evangelism. After that, we're going to have a five-week series on the subject of technology and how as Christians, with a Christian worldview, we are called to relate to technology. Everyone I've told about the potential of teaching on this has seemed very excited. So that will be a great opportunity to invite folks, especially folks with young kids who are trying to figure out how to navigate this brave new world that we're in. So again, welcome. We're glad that you're here with us this morning. At this time, we will now receive God's tithes and our offerings.
My love, my hurt,
Lord Jesus, you paid it all, and so we gladly give back to you our tithe, your tithe, and our free will offerings. We ask you to take these gifts, multiply them, increase them, do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think through them, and hasten the day when the whole creation every knee will bow before you and confess your lordship to the glory of God the Father, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Well, I'd invite you to turn with me, if you have a copy of the scriptures, to the first chapter of the book of Ephesians. We're in week two of a brand new series as we work verse by verse through this book. We'll be reading today verses 7 through 14. Ephesians 1, 7 through 14. Before I read it, let me pray for us. Let us pray. Father, thank you for giving us this word, the word of God, inspired, inerrant, infallible, is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path. Please help us now to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest it. Send your spirit now for Christ's sake, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Starting in verse 7. In him, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. All flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. I think in themes. That was something I learned early on in my Christian life, and I think it's something that served me well. And so when I look at a passage like Ephesians 1:7, the immediate theme that presents itself to you is redemption. And so I've had the last couple of weeks to just have that theme of redemption in my mind. And if you'll spend a couple of weeks with a biblical theme in your mind, you'll be amazed the things in the world that will present themselves to you, that will be a part of that topic, will be associated with that topic, will be relevant to that topic. And for instance, I had the famous Rousseau quote come to mind where he said, "Man is born free, but everywhere is in chains." And, you know, G.K. Chesterton slightly modified that quote for capitalistic society when he said, "Man is born free, but everywhere is in chain stores." Yes, it's a great quote. You can use it. Support local. But then I was rereading over the, used to be an old tradition of mine with my daughters, kind of went away for a long time, but I decided to revisit Charles Dickens' book, A Christmas Carol. And, you know, I've seen a couple versions of the movie. One thing that I have not seen in a movie that comes out in the book is how Marley's chains were put together. The ghost of Marley appears. He always has chains on. But in the book, the chains are a little different than what I've seen in the movies. This is a quote from the book about Marley. "The chain he drew was clasped about his middle. It was long and wound about him like a tail, and it was made, for Scrooge observed it closely, of cash boxes, keys, padlocks, ledgers, deeds, and heavy purses wrought in steel." "You are fettered," said Scrooge, trembling. "Tell me why." "I wear the chain I forged in life," replied the ghost. "I made it, link by link, yard by yard. I girded it on of my own free will, and of my own free will I wore it. Is its pattern strange to you?" he says to Scrooge. And that's the great warning. You see these chains that I'm wearing? These chains bear the things that I worshiped in this life. Money, cash registers, safes. And you're forging the exact same chain around yourself. And then the whole story is, how are we going to break Scrooge free from these materialistic chains? Then I was driving randomly down the road a while back and had the radio on some random station, and an Eagles song came on. The great theologians, the Eagles, right? Already gone. And there's a great line in this. As I've gotten older, one of the things I do, I actually listen to lyrics of songs now and try to, you know, when you're younger, I think it just, does it sound good? That's kind of all you think about. But you actually start listening to lyrics every once in a while, you'll get some gold and even some sermon material if you're a preacher. Well, I know it wasn't you who held me down. Heaven knows it wasn't you who set me free. So oftentimes it happens that we live our lives in chains and never even know that we have the key. Boy, that's true. That's so true. When Paul says in our text that we have redemption through the blood of Christ, he is drawing on a long biblical history and a rich biblical theology dating back to the Exodus, when God's people were literally fettered, when they're in bondage, when they were in slavery in Egypt, and God brought them out with a mighty redeeming hand. And if that wasn't great enough in and of itself, the rest of the Bible teaches us that though that event was real and true, it also pointed metaphorically to a greater deliverance, a greater breaking of chains and bondage that we all need, and that's the bondage that everyone is born with in this world, to the world and the flesh and the devil, the bondage to the false gods that we worship. God says that since sin entered the world, everyone has been born in spiritual bondage, enslaved to the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the kicker is, most people don't even realize it. They don't realize that they're forging chains of their own free will, link by link, yard by yard. And if we're blessed enough, God will open our eyes so that we can see it. Like in that fictional story, the ghosts do for Scrooge. Paul says, Christ holds the key. He is the ultimate key to your freedom. He sets captives free. He is the firstborn who dies so that we can be delivered from bondage, the bondage of the world, the flesh, the devil, and our own sin. And so for those of us who are Christians, this is not new news, clearly. I mean, it's communicated so well even in the hymns that we've sung so far today. We know this. We know Christ is our Redeemer. We say it all the time. But we still find ourselves tempted to forget this. Tempted like the Israelites, as they're wandering in the wilderness. Let's go back to Egypt. We were more comfortable there. We had food there. We had shelter there. They had been broken free from their chains and were willing to submit again to them. And so too Christians are tempted to return to old chains that formerly bound us, or to forge new chains that might bind us in the future, forgetting that Christ has given us the key to redemption in his death. Though we forget we have the key, or at times we forget how to use it. I can't do justice to this passage that we read. It's amazing. The reality is we've been sealed by the Spirit of God for the day of judgment. He has sealed us into the kingdom of God. He is protecting us from the wrath and justice of God. We've been guaranteed an inheritance in heaven and in the new heavens and the new earth from God beyond anything we could possibly have ever dreamt of. But often we live as though we're captives, free, but everywhere in chains. Chained to sin, chained to fear, chained to guilt, chained to shame, chained to anxiety, chained to technology, plug for the Wednesday night series, chained to the past, chained to the fear of the future, free, but everywhere in chains. I can tell you this over and over and over. It is objectively true, and if you're a believer, you know it. But the question is, subjectively, how do you live your freedom out? We could talk about that for a year. I can only make one point today. Part of the answer to how we live out our freedom in Christ has to do with how we look at time. Yes, time, how we look at time. Seems very simple, but 3 points about how we look at time and how it affects how we live out our freedom in Christ. Number one, time is a creature. Number two, Time is a gift. Number three, time can be redeemed. Number one, time is a creature. I was listening to someone, listening to a preacher recently who made this point, and he called time a creature. And I thought, that's a strange thing to call time. But actually, if you think about it, we know it's a part of creation. But things that are part of creation are what? Creatures. Time is a creature. God has no beginning. God is eternal. But Genesis 1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning. That's when time started. Jesus, during his earthly ministry, said that the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. God created the Sabbath. He created days. He created time. It's a creature. Time is a creature, just as much as you are a creature, as I'm a creature, as your pet dog is a creature. And so just as God has control over humanity and the destiny of men and nations, so he has control over time. Time obeys God. I hate to say it, like your pet obeys you, but better, of course, because he's sovereign and all-powerful. Part of God's promise to Noah in the flood is, remember this verse. Genesis 8:22. God promises, we tend to think of God's promise in the flood to be simply that he would never flood the earth again, catastrophically. But there's much more to it than that. He says, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, shall not cease. The sun is going to keep rising as long as God keeps saying, get up. As long as he keeps saying, get up, it's going to keep rising. Because he's the Lord of time, it obeys him. And as such, he uses time to accomplish his purposes. You see this in our passage. This is where we're going to park for most of our time. Ephesians 1:10 says, as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. So this great redemptive work accomplished by Christ, the sealing of the Spirit, the promise of this great inheritance, they're all a part of the plan of the fullness of time in which, as the hymn says, Jesus who died will be satisfied and earth and heaven be one. So God has a plan for time. The Greek word the ESV translates plan for the fullness of time means something like the administration of a house or business. Like you have a plan for your house. You know how to, you want to organize it. You want to get your children together and all that sort of thing. Or plan for your business. You have a plan for your house, for your business. God has a plan for all of time. That's the idea. And Paul says in verse 10, again, that Christ's redemptive work, the forgiveness of our sins, the grace of God are all a plan for the fullness of time. That phrase, the fullness of time, is used twice in the New Testament. Both times by Paul. In Galatians, Christ was born in the fullness of time. In Ephesians, Christ will return in the fullness of time. So the idea is that he came to earth at the exact right moment and that he will return to earth at the exact right moment. You know, picture an hourglass. You turn it over, the sand begins to drain. Eventually, the bottom part of that hourglass gets full. That's the fullness of time. That's when the timer goes off. That's when Christ is going to return. When the hourglass of God's plan is finally fulfilled. So imagine God setting this hourglass at the exact right time he sends Jesus, at the exact right time he will send Jesus again to the earth. You know, one of my favorite scenes in the Fellowship of the Ring movie from The Lord of the Rings is Gandalf is late to the Shire and Frodo goes out and meets him and he says, Gandalf, you're late. And Gandalf's a wizard, right? And Gandalf said, wizards are never late. Wizards arrive precisely when they intend to arrive. And Christ arrived to the earth precisely when God intended for him to arrive. And he will return precisely when God intends for him to return. That's what Paul's saying. Now, the reason this is relevant for living in freedom is this. Part of our problem is that we are all tempted at times to think God is not present. Where are you, God? That God is running late? That, boy, I've got something I really want God to do, and he sure seems to be running at the last minute. And Paul is telling us God always shows up exactly when he intends to, and you have to remember that. Now, so time is a creature. God is in control of it, and he shows up precisely when he wants. That's number one. Number two, time is a gift. It doesn't always feel like it, but time is a gift to us. Paul says that God revealing his plan to us is a gift. The grace, the knowledge, all these things lavished on us, they're a gift. In 1 Timothy, Paul will go on to say that it's God who gives us all things richly to enjoy. Time is a part of his creation, and therefore time is a gift to us. One author said, profound quote I came across recently, "Time exists in order that everything doesn't happen all at once. And space exists so that it doesn't all happen to you." Now, you could chew on that quote for a few months, really. It's deep. It's very deep. One of my favorite books is Death by Living by N.D. Wilson. And he has a great chapter called The Blessed Lash of Time. This is a lengthy quote, but I'm going to read it to you. And just try to track with me. It's good. He says, "Time motivates us. Sure, time counts up, but it is also a game clock counting down. It is urgent. It makes now matter. Oh, we've got all the time in the world," says the man preparing to do nothing. "This is due tomorrow," says the woman, suddenly finding focus. Time is a kindness. We need it. We need loss to appreciate gift. We need the world chanting at us like a crowd counting down seconds at the end of a shot clock. Imagine being your flawed self without time. Think about your temper, your resentfulness, your lust, your lies, your selfishness, your despair. Think about all the trouble you have on the inside. Think about the weight of that burden. Now remove time. There is no end to this race. There is no finish line. There is no final round to this brawl. There is no clock counting down. You must struggle with your temper always, forever. You will be 700 years old, still a lusting lecher weeping with guilt, a 1,000-year-old woman who can't stop her poisonous tongue. When young athletes train hard, a good coach is there. When they push themselves to dizziness, to vomiting, a coach is counting down. You can do it, just 3 more, just 5 more minutes, 2 more laps, you can do this. And we find that we can, that we can push harder than we ever knew, because once we have, we'll be done. Imagine running and running and running until your throat burns with welling acid from your gut and constricts with the sharp bursts of cold breaths that your screaming lungs grab and grab and grab to keep your body moving. Your coach is on the side. He shouts, "It won't ever stop. You will never be done. Just keep going." Me, I drop right there. Without a finish line, I quit. And he concludes, "Because of death, we can run the good race. We can fight the good fight. Completion exists. 70 years, 80 if you're strong, less if you're like the Messiah. Look to him and receive more grace. Stagger on." That's a good motto for life. Stagger on. You can do it. Only a decade more, or 2, or 4, but there is a finish line. There will be an end to the weight on your back and the ache in your skull. You know, Blaise Pascal said we spend so much time worried about regrets of the past and thinking about anxieties of the future, we almost never live in the present. He says, hoping to live someday, we never end up living today. What Wilson's quote shows us, and it's the message of the Bible from front to back, is time is short, but it is a gift, and so we need to live. You know, one of my favorite little theological poems by Ralph Erskine, he says, "The law says obey, and life you'll win, but grace says live, for all is done." Christ has done everything we need to have not only eternal life, but to have fullness of life in the present. Do not let things from your past cause you to walk in chains in the gift that you have that is the present. Do not let anxieties about your future cause you to walk in chains in the gift we have that is the present. God is the Lord of time, not you. And time is a gift to you. And the fact that your heart is beating is a gift. Remember In the Christmas carol, how does Scrooge get freed from his bondage? The ghosts of Christmas past and present and future. The message of the Bible is the past, the present, and the future is all working together for your salvation. You know, the odds, I should have put this in my notes. I didn't think about it today. I said it on a Wednesday night a while back. I read an article that talked about the odds of any one of us being alive are astronomically insane. Like the odds that you exist from a worldly perspective are the odds that someone in a helicopter takes a life preserver, throws it into the ocean, and a giant sea turtle happens to be right there and it lands on his head like a ring. That's the odds that you exist. The present is a gift. Today is one closer to the day in which God is going to unite all things together in heaven and earth. The clock is ticking. Now is the day. Lastly, time can be redeemed. When you know that time is a gift, that's when you know you have to redeem it. You say, well, I want to change, but it seems too late, or things just seem too dark. I've been in these chains too long. You've been redeemed by Christ. You've been sealed by the Spirit. Paul is going to tell you later in Ephesians, he's going to say, you're a child of light. Walk in the light. Darkness can't overcome you because it didn't overcome Christ. I recently watched an interview with a gentleman named Tim Grover, and he's a personal trainer, very sought-after personal trainer, who was Michael Jordan's personal trainer for years and years, and Jordan had an exclusive contract with him. As long as you're working with me, you can't work with anybody else, so he's good. And then after Jordan retired, he said, I'll allow you to work with Kobe Bryant, but that's it. And so he started, he works with the great of the great, and he says one of the things he tells his clients, is that they have to embrace the darkness of midnight if they're going to win in their professions. You lose a game, you have a bad season, you lose a championship, you have a serious injury, those are midnights. For a normal person, it is you lose your job. The stock market wipes you out. You get divorced. You go through different tragedies in life. That's a midnight, he says. But, he says, I thought this was profound. When does a new day start? Midnight. Every new day starts in darkness, in the black of midnight. And he said, you need to remember that so that when you're going through darkness, you can say a new day may be just around the edge of the corner. Aren't you enjoying these days as the sun is actually starting to set a little later than it was a few weeks? A new day's coming. We made it through Christmas. We made it through the solstice. A new day's coming. Do you believe that's possible for your life? You look at the saints of the Bible. You look at Job. When did his new day come? Darkness. You can go on and on. Joseph, in a dungeon, imprisoned, becomes the prime minister of Egypt. New days start in the blackness of midnight. And so Paul is going to tell us, redeem the time. This is later in the book of Ephesians, in chapter 5, verse 16. Redeem the time because the days are evil. Because Christ has redeemed you, you can now redeem the time. That's the idea. The Greek language has multiple words for times. This is fascinating. In Ephesians 1, Paul, when he talks about the fullness of time, Paul uses the word chronos. That is tick-tock, tick-tock, the standard progression of time, the sands passing through the hourglass. In Ephesians 5, when Paul tells us to redeem the time, he uses the word kairos. Kairos is an interesting word with an interesting history. You know, the ancient god or mythological character personification of Kairos was one of the most fascinating looking beings you'll ever see. He had wings, and he had, my friend Jeremy Beck says, a reverse mullet. He had no hair on the back of his head, but long hair on the front of his head. So he was all business in the back, all party in the front, as they say. But the idea was he would fly towards you at an opportune moment. He was the god of opportunity, of chance, of luck. And when he flew towards you, you had to grab him while he was approaching because once he passed, there was no hair to grab. Teaching a very powerful point. Like Dead Poets Society, I thought of that movie this past week as I was preparing. He refers to that, Robin Williams' character, the teacher, the English teacher, literary teacher, refers to the poem by Robert Herrick called To the Virgins, To Make Much of Time, which starts with the phrase, "Gather ye rosebuds while ye may." And he has the students walk out into, you know, the trophy gallery, and they're looking at all these pictures of young men in black and white who had previously been at that school, who are now, as Robin Williams says, pushing up daisies somewhere. And he says to them, "Gather ye rosebuds while ye may." Lean forward, listen to what these men are going to say to you. Some of y'all know what he says. "Carpe diem. Carpe diem. Seize the day, boys. Seize the day, boys." That's the idea of redeeming the time. Seize the day. Grab it by the hair and pull it in. We can you've been redeemed, so have as many redeeming moments in your life as you can possibly have. Embrace those moments. Don't be so busy just daydreaming as you drive your car that you don't look at a sunset, you know, that you don't appreciate your children or your grandchildren, children that you don't appreciate your parents. I'm young enough to remember what it was like not giving a second thought to what my parents were going through in their own lives, because I was just so consumed with myself. You know, I've told a story, I won't retell the whole story, but Chuck Palahniuk, one of my favorite stories. He was in Paris promoting a book. His grandmother died in the States. He wanted to go back, but he couldn't because he had an obligation. These French folks sent him on this grand adventure where he ends up underneath the Eiffel Tower at precisely midnight when the lights go out. And it's supposed to be one of the most mesmerizing things you can see in Paris. And something I'd forgotten about this story, I re-listened to it not too long ago. As he said, he heard the voice in that moment as he looked up at the beauty of the Eiffel Tower at midnight. And he heard the voice of his grandmother say, "Chuck, we were created to experience moments like this." Don't miss those moments you were created to experience because you're so stuck in the past and so anxious about the future. Frederick Buechner tells the story. He had a period of his life where his daughter was wrestling with a debilitating illness. They didn't know what was going to happen to her, and he was depressed, and he was anxious. And he said, "I remember sitting parked by the roadside once, terribly depressed and afraid about my daughter's illness and what was going on in our family, when out of nowhere a car came along down the highway with a license plate that bore on it the one word out of all the words in the dictionary that I needed most to see at that exact moment. The word was trust." It turned out it was somebody who worked at a bank. He found out years later, the person found him, this famous story. But he says he needed to see it at that moment. He says, "I believe that people laugh at coincidence as a way of relegating it to the realm of the absurd, and therefore not having to take seriously the possibility that there is a lot more going on in our lives than we either know or care to know. Who can say what it is that's going on? But I suspect that part of it, anyway, is that every once and so often, we hear a whisper from the wings that goes something like this: you've turned up in the right place at the right time. Don't ever think that you've been forgotten." That's just another way of saying seize the day. Carpe diem. You're at the right place at the right time, and don't you ever think you've been forgotten. Somebody here needs to hear that today. Your chains can fall off. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace to us. Redeemed how we love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Father, help us to live in the freedom that Christ has purchased for us. For we ask it in his name. Amen. Well, we come now to the Lord's table, which is always an interesting place to be because it brings past, present, and future together, doesn't it? We look forward to the future when we will share in the marriage supper of the Lamb. We think about the past and what Christ did for us on Calvary when he won the victory over sin, death, hell, and the grave that we're celebrating today. So as we think about the future and that marriage supper and the past and what Christ has done, let's not forget the present. When you hear the words of institution, that this is his body and blood given for you, take it in. It's the most important thing you can possibly hear at this moment. If you are a non-believer who has not put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we ask that you would not participate in this meal, but instead would let the elements just simply pass by in the aisle. Stay here. We're glad that you're here. But in the light of the claims of Christ's gospel, his redeeming love, I'd encourage you to repent of your sins and put your trust in Christ. There will be no better moment than this moment right now. Seize the day. Now is the day of salvation. And for those of us who are believers, where would you rather be? Marv Levy used to say that to his football team. I loved the Buffalo Bills when I was a kid. And he used to tell his players, where would you rather be? Where would you rather be right now? On the night in which our Lord was betrayed, he took bread and broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in like manner, after the supper, he took the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the remission of your sins. Drink from it, all of you. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. The words to the next hymn are in your bulletin. Let's stand and sing Victory in Jesus. Live in victory, my friends. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all as we continue this, our short earthly pilgrimage. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen.